good morning, church family. How are you today? Wow, you really are good. It's so great to see all of you guys here this morning. And to everybody online, hello to you as well. We're so excited that you can join with us with that technology, but we sure can't wait till we can see you in person soon. So this morning, guys, I just want to thank you so much for all of your donations and everything you contributed to the Easter eggs. We have the opportunity today, right after second service, if you want to stick around, we'll even provide food for you to actually stuff those eggs. Who's excited about that? Hey, there are thousands of eggs downstairs and they are ready to be stuffed. So again, if you want to hang out right after second service today, we're going to be stuffing those eggs. And we are so excited for the impact that those eggs are going to make in our community as we just make connections with people and just love on people. So thank you again so much for all of that. On April 7th, we have New Life Sunday coming up where we get to celebrate the blessings of not only new babies, new life, but also new life in Christ with baptism. If you are interested in either of those things, please go online to myclc.info/next-steps, and you'll be able to read about it there, as well as any of our staff members, any of our team members here, hit us up, and we'll be happy to fill you in on that as well. Well, this morning, I have the honor and privilege of bringing up our board nominees coming up for our voting that will be happening on March 17th. So while they are coming forward, I'd like to invite Finn Ickes and Lynn Gillix to come to the front. These amazing humans. I want to just take a moment to explain to you guys, I love that, our church family is awesome. I want to just explain for a minute just kind of how the governance of our church family works. In CLC, we actually have a partnership of a board of directors and our staff at CLC, and that's how the decisions are made for the running of our church family. And so we are in a season now where it's time to transition some existing board members and welcome new board member to our family, and we're going to be doing that voting on March 17th, as I said, but we have two faithful who have been willing to accept the nomination for that process, and that is Ben and Lynn. And I just wanted to give you an opportunity to put a face with a name, Ben and Lynn. She goes by Aunt Linny. The entire town of Mogford knows Aunt Linny. Is it Uncle Benny? Is that how that goes? Aunt Linny and Uncle Benny, I don't know, that could be a thing, right? Yeah, you heard it here first, I'm just saying. but anyway, what we would like you guys to do, we received a booklet on your way in. It has all of the information about these two awesome individuals. And we just like you to be in prayer over the next couple of weeks as far as who God is leading for your vote for the board. We do have one opening at this time for the board of directors. And again, these awesome humans have just stepped up and being willing to accept that nomination. We're just so grateful for that in leading God's church. So at this time, I'd like to invite Pastor Gordon to come up and just pray over our process, pray over these nominees, and just kind of be with us as we seek his will for CLC.
All right. Let's take a moment and just pray over these individuals and pray over our church family as we seek unity and to be on mission together as our focus is to love God, love people, and make disciples. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, and we're so grateful for this time and for this space. Thank you for these individuals, for Ben and for Lynn. I thank you for the privilege of being able to walk through life with them, to be able to serve you with alongside their gifts and their abilities, their talents, their leadership, and their capacity. I pray that you would place a person in this time in the role that is going to serve as the next individual on the board of directors. Only if you allow, we will do this and we will do that. We trust the outcome regardless because we're going to continue to move forward in a great way to honor you and to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name, all God's people say, amen. Amen. All right, let's thank the Lord for these two eyes. Go ahead and have a seat. All right, let's stand together and let's worship through song.
Let's sing about God's goodness today. Searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fade, never enough. But you came along, put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing
is so good to praise the Lord for what he can do in our lives. I mean, that's such a great song to see what God can do throughout the history of Scripture, how he turned bones into armies, how he turns graves into gardens. He gives us beauty for ashes. And it's just so good to praise God for how patient he is with us. Amen. He's patient with us as believers, those who have come to know him through Christ. And he's also patient with those who don't know Jesus, waiting for them to come to know him. He doesn't want anyone to perish, it says in 2 Peter, that he doesn't want anyone to perish. He wants all to come to know Christ. And then for those of us who are in Christ, he's very patient with us to mature. He's patient with us to grow and to completely work out our sanctification as he guides us in his word. The only problem is that we get distracted, we get fearful, we get offended, we want it to be our way, and we may not want to open up our heart to say, how could I be wrong? How do I need to grow and learn and receive that patience that he has for us to be corrected? That's the only way we're going to mature as a church body and to be fully effective in Christ and to really truly reach the unbeliever, is that we have to be willing to be wrong and receive God's patience with us as he corrects us and grows us and matures us. So let's give him our fear this morning. Let's give him the reasons why we don't want to be wrong. Let's give him the reasons why we feel fearful to trust this morning.
Tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know. No, I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. To the lies, I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. No, I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, when we stand in your love, there's power that can break off every chain. Oh, there's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that there's power in your name, power in your name. There's power that can break off every chain. Sing it out, church. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power. Chance when I stand in
shake us in Christ. Everything else will shake, but nothing can shake us. Let's praise him for the sacrifice that he gave for us to become, to know God and his completeness.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. Days we will sing your praise, oh Lord, oh Lord our God. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again, oh trample. Blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Good morning. I'll be reading 2 Corinthians 7:10. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves you no regret, but worldly sorrow brings death. Let us pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come boldly and humbly today before you in worship of how great and amazing you are. Lord, we just give thanks for the love that you give us that we don't deserve, but yet you do it anyways. You came to the cross and sacrificed so much for us when it should have been us up there. Lord, we just ask for your love that you already give us. Lord, I pray that as Pastor comes up to share the message, that you bless him. You give us open ears and an open heart to receive his message, and let us hear from your word what you're trying to say to us. Lord, we ask for all of our Christian brothers and sisters across the world that are suffering today. Just be with them, give them strength, and let them know that this world is not our home, that you have promised us eternity with you, and that's what we should focus on. Lord, please be with Israel as they continue to fight and suffer, as so much wrath is coming upon them because that's your chosen land, and we need to remember them and pray for them. I give you all the glory and honor, praise, and we just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church family. Open your Bibles. We're going to start with, let's just go there together. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 7. And then, of course, you know we're going through Matthew. So you're going to put your thumb in 2 Corinthians chapter 7 there. We're going to touch on one verse that's going to give us a lens for what we're learning today. And then we're going to be going over to Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26. Today and next week, we're going to be looking at two men. One of them knew about Jesus, while the other really loved Jesus. Today's big idea is to focus on a tale of two failures, because these two men both failed. Next week, we're going to look at two very different outcomes. So today we're looking at a tale of two failures. Matthew 26 is similar to a movie or a short film, if you will, where there's lots of things going on what appear to be at the same time, where you have a view of what's happening in this scene, and then it goes over to the same day, the same time around that, where something else is going on, and it's putting together a picture of life happening between multiple families, maybe multiple people, multiple situations. And when you read Matthew 26, you can see that same consistent flow of these scenes. And so I'm going to encourage you to stay focused and on track, because this sometimes you can get lost when you're like, wait, where are we now? Because we're tracking with the movie, if you will, the theme of what's happening in Matthew 26. Now, Matthew 26, interestingly enough, is in the top like four longest chapters of any chapter within all of Scripture. And so we're going to be doing some paraphrasing a little bit, some summarizing, and a lot of reading. So we're going to be going through Matthew 26 so we understand the story. The reason why we're in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, the reason why Ben read that to us, is because we're going to view Matthew 26, we're going to view these two men through this lens, because it's vitally important for us to be aware of where we are and also where people in our life are. We're all going to experience this thing called sorrow. In fact, it's even a good thing. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10. For the kind of sorrow God wants us to experience leads us away from sin and results in salvation. There's no regret for that kind of sorrow, but worldly sorrow, which lacks repentance, results in spiritual death. Now let's look at this word sorrow for a minute so we understand the sorrow we're going to be walking through in Matthew chapter 26. We're talking about pain. We're talking about grief. We're talking about annoyance. We're talking about affliction. And one word that probably can sum it all up that we can actually feel is this level of heaviness. The sorrow. We've all experienced some level of sorrow, haven't we? Some of which life has happened to us, and other times we have happened to life. It's been our choices that brought on sorrow. And so God here in this scripture, 2 Corinthians says, for the kind of sorrow, so Paul is writing this, inspired by the Holy Spirit, for the kind of sorrow that God wants us to experience leads us away from sin. How many times have you gone through something really tough and you found yourself being distant from God? That's not the right approach for us. As believers, we should allow that sorrow to draw us closer to God. And in this specific context, we're talking about when we need to repent. Because sorrow, let's put it in mathematical terms. Sorrow plus repentance equals restoration. You can become restored. A moment, even relationally, I'm so sorry that I offended you when I said that. Will you forgive me? I forgive you, right? And then there's restoration, there's a restoring relationship. Now, sorrow minus repentance equals emotion. That's why people will come to an altar like this or in a conference, like a mega conference, and they'll go down every year and get saved every year. When I say get saved, I mean, let's put some quotes on that, right? Get saved every year. Because there was a movement. They were moved. They were touched. They were emotional. And they went forward and they did a thing. And there really wasn't repentance where they turned away from their sin. They just got excited. And so I feel so bad, but I'm not trying to change anything. So I'm going to go down and have an emotional moment. Then you realize nothing's changing in my life. This must not have stuck. You ever been there? Yeah. Growing up, oftentimes, especially in as a teenager, I remember seeing that so often where people would go forward and say, I'm giving my life to Jesus, and we would celebrate that person every year. Every year. Wait a second, you got saved three times. I'm sure one of these is going to happen. One of these times, it's coming for you, right? It's going to happen. And so we need to understand this. Sorrow plus repentance is restoration. Sorrow minus repentance is emotion. Where are you? I want you to think about this. Where are you with sorrow? Is there repentance with it? Because we all have something going on, no doubt. Oftentimes, it's a secret sin that we don't want anybody to know, or it's my only vice, or it's not that big a deal. But the truth is, it is a big deal because it separates us from a holy God. We are in the final days of the earthly ministry of the life of Jesus. Now flip back, we're further in the New Testament, to Matthew chapter 26, and we're going to start in verse 1. Now, of course, as you know, I teach from the New Living Translation, and so I will be reading from there. There's a lot that I'm going to be going through today. I will try to help you understand some of your translations as well as we go along. He's in his earthly, the last week of his earthly ministry, the life of Jesus, the Messiah. Jesus and his disciples were on the Mount of Olives, and they're starting now to disband a little bit from there. They are there in Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. Remember, Passover for a Jewish person was a big deal to celebrate this in Jerusalem. Everybody wanted to go, and if they didn't make it one time, they had a special saying, which I cannot pronounce, that said, you know, next year for sure, we're going to Jerusalem. This was a big deal, and they made it a point to be there. Matthew chapter 26 and in verse 1, when Jesus had finished saying these things, this is the Olivet Discourse we just went over, and also summarizing like all, not that he summarized it here in this text, but that he had just got through all of his major, like he's done with his major discourses, like he's done with his major sermons. Now the words are less and less, and just his behavior, his walking, his journey to the cross. crosses more and more. And so when he gets done saying these things, he said to his disciples, as you know, because he's been saying this continually, hey, you know what, I'm going to die, this is going to happen. He just got done talking about how Jerusalem, the temple, is going to be destroyed. As you know, Passover begins in 2 days, and the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified. Now, let's switch our point of view. We see the disciples, we see Jesus, and they're having this conversation saying, hey, Passover's coming, you know, I have to die. You were switching our point of view to a different scene happening at the same time. How do we know this? Verse 3. At the same time, the leading priests and the elders were meeting at the residence of Caiaphas, the high priest, plotting how to capture Jesus secretly and kill him. But not during the Passover celebration, they agreed, or people may riot. How nice. Yeah, let's not mess up one of our festivals with your murder. We get so blinded by our behaviors, we don't even hear what we say anymore. We get so caught up in like, well, of course, it's justified. I should be able to do this, or I'm going to get away with this, or it's actually an honoring thing. It's a holy thing. Mark records that this was not the first time that these religious leaders would have gotten together. They were continually, the word continually, seeking a time to stop Jesus. Imagine holding on to such hatred toward a person that you were continually talking about whether or not something along the lines of maybe an arrest or even killing them. We may not go there today, but we certainly have daggers with our words. And we will talk about their stuff over and over and over again. We're so good at it, we'll put it online on things called social media. It's an amazing spiritual gift that we get such boldness to declare false truth online. Don't we? Don't we do that? We do it on Facebook. We do it on X, which was formerly Twitter. Keep up with me, people. Come on. And so, and then you've got Instagram, and you've got Snapchat, and you've got TikTok, and you've got all these different places. And then you have all these next door apps in which you can go onto, and you can talk really bad about your community. It's so fun. And you can go on there, and everybody's going back and forth and back and forth. They don't even really know each other, but they agree with each other in that moment. And so we lay out all this stuff continually. We're not so different from the Pharisees. The difference is the cultural approach is just different. Now, at the same point, Jesus and his disciples disband for a long enough time, maybe a day and a half or 2 days, before we see them talking again, because now we're switching again. Either during this meeting, in comes Judas, right? They're sitting around, how are we going to get rid of this guy, Jesus? And either Judas walks in and becomes their answer, or maybe a little bit later, he got a hold of the religious leaders. In verse 14, then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 disciples, went to the leading priests and asked, how much will you pay me to betray Jesus to you? And they gave him 30 pieces of silver. From that time on, Judas began looking for an opportunity to betray Jesus. He was already living in sin, we know, because this was a continual thing that he was thinking about. We know that he was stealing. But if you could just sit in this moment for this next second or two, and just, I want you to think about this. Judas was a part of the group. He wasn't an outlier. He wasn't an outcast. He wasn't like, he didn't get second fiddle to any, like, he was a part of the group. Traveled, had conversations, went forth. He was a part of the family. There was 12 brothers, and he was one of the 12, experiencing intimate moments with the team, not just casual, oh yeah, I kind of know them, oh yeah, I know about them, but I'm talking about there was a time, 2, 3, even long years of time that they're just together, watching Jesus do things that nobody else was able to do. Sharing things and being taught things that nobody else was saying, preaching with authority that nobody else had. And yet Judas is there the whole time. the majority of the disciples were there the whole time. And yet there were these moments that just... Because he's the one that that knew about Jesus, but didn't fully love Jesus. Oh, Lord our God, how many people sit in pews or really modern, nice, fancy chairs today in a place that we would call a church building and don't even know how quickly they would betray Jesus for money? Oh, I would never. Oh, you can't even pin that on me, Pastor. You know as well as I do, I'm in it for the long haul. That's what we're going to see the disciples say too. And yet, it turns out different. Now, let's switch our point of view again. We're about two days later. 2 days later. This is where on the screen it pops up. 2 days later. About 2 days later, the disciples asked Jesus, hey, where do you want us to prepare the Passover? And Jesus says, hey, as soon as... Now, I'm reading. This is the view of Luke here, chapter 22. As soon as you enter Jerusalem, a man carrying a pitcher of water will meet you, which will be easy to find because typically there wouldn't be guys walking around pitchers of water. It would have been the ladies walking around. So it would have been very easily identifiable. Follow him. At the house that he enters, say to the owner, Jesus always had the most interesting things like, hey, this is just going to happen this way. Tell the owner, hey, the teacher asked, where is the guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples? And he will take you upstairs. To an upper room. Sound familiar? This is that room. This is the upper room. Many scholars agree that this could very well have been not just the space where they eat Passover and they have this inaugural communion, but also from Acts chapter 1, verse 13, where the Holy Spirit came upon the disciples. Tradition would place it at a certain location, though we don't know for sure. But many scholars would agree, wow, this is where the upper room comes into play. Now, we're going into the evening. Remember, the Jewish days start at night. Not in the morning. We wake up in the morning, my day begins. Their days, the way their calendar works, their days begin at nighttime, when the sun goes down. So when it was evening, verse 20 of Matthew 26, when it was evening, Jesus sat down at the table of the 12, and when they were eating, he said, I tell you the truth that one of you will betray me. Jesus isn't making small talk here. He just like lays out the truth. They're eating, having a meal. They're celebrating Passover for crying out loud. Like this is a moment. This is a meal. And he lays it out. I tell you the truth that one of you will betray me. Greatly distressed, each one asked in turn. So this is like, I can't think of a better explanation or a visual for this than the movie, the TV show, That 70s Show. All right. Don't judge me on this, okay? I've seen a couple episodes, but I don't endorse it. But when they're in their basement and they're talking, there's this frame where they go to the person and then immediately goes to the next person. You with me? It goes to the next person. This is like that. One at a time, in a row, they say, am I the one, Lord? Am I the one, Lord? Am I the one, Lord? Greatly distressed. Right? So there's this heaviness, this sorrow that is coming over them, and they're asking in turn, wait a second, who's going to betray you? Who's going to betray you? Like, is it me? Is it me? Is it me? He replied, one of you who has just eaten from this bowl with me will betray me. For the Son of Man must die. This is going to happen. It has to happen, as the scriptures declare long ago. But how terrible it will be for the one who betrays him. The one that's actually linked to this will be identified with this forever. When you read through the New Testament, whenever it comes up to talk about Judas, and let's say it's a Judas that was different than Judas Iscariot, it'll even say Judas, not Iscariot. What an interesting thought that you would live your life in such a way for you. Actually, this is not just a moment that it occurred. This was an ongoing building up of habitual sin, and eventually got to a place where he now betrays Jesus. Oh, how terrible it'll be for that one. It would be far better if that man, he had not even been born. Wow, that sounds pretty intense. It would be better for you to just not ever live than for you to follow through with this betrayal. I wonder what our lives would look like if we decided to live that a little bit differently. What if we said, okay, so as believers, we have this opportunity to sin, right? So we have this choice to sin, Romans 6 and 7. Like, you have a choice. You get to decide, am I going to follow the flesh or am I going to follow the Spirit? I can live in flesh and my evil desires, or I can follow the Spirit and live according to the Holy Spirit. Imagine if I chose to, in that moment, say, okay, this could be that moment in which I choose to deny Jesus or choose to betray him. This could define the whole rest of my life. This could be that moment where I walk into this sin and it could have been better that I would never born. You guys are like, that's intense. We treat sin so flippantly. Well, it's at least I didn't kill anybody. Well, at least I didn't steal that much. Well, at least I didn't. We try to minimize our own sin. Then you put the same person, do the same thing on TV, and all of a sudden, oh yeah, he needs to die. Oh yeah, he needs to go away. This needs to happen. Justice, people. And we would say, oh yeah, justice across the board. But for me, it wasn't that big of a deal. It was just a little bit. I'm sure Judas had moments where he was just, you know, it's not that big of a deal. After all, I work hard. And it's not that, you know, it's not that big of a deal. You know what? If God didn't want me to steal it, he wouldn't have put me in charge as treasurer. Do you hear yourself? Right? We say these ridiculously crazy, weird things. Judas, the one who would betray him in verse 25, also asked, Rabbi, am I the one? What an interesting question from Judas. Now, perhaps maybe he was seeking to find out whether or not Jesus knew, which is an interesting thought in and of itself, because then you don't realize he's really God, right? Like, you understand, you've seen him do all these things, but it never got in. You never grabbed a hold of it. You never let it in. Such arrogance. He already has the money in his hand. You understand that, right? He already has the money. He's just waiting on an opportunity to turn him over. And he says, oh, is it me? Such blindness, such pride. Jesus looks at him and says, you have said it, which is a longer way of saying, yes. What's so fascinating is that in this moment, I mean, I guess you have a bunch of guys sitting around a table, so we don't always pay a whole lot of attention to certain things. And so he says this thing, and they don't all get what he said. Am I the one that'll betray you? Yes. And they're going, wait, what? What happened? Here's why I say this. John chapter, we're switching a little bit of a point of view here again. Now, John chapter 13, I don't typically bring in John, but I think this is significant enough in our series of Matthew and Friends and the synoptics to bring John into this a little bit here. Because John records that in verse 27, when Judas had eaten the bread that Satan entered him, then Jesus told him, he's looking at Judas and says, hurry and do what you're going to do. And Judas now appears to leave the table before they ever have their communion inaugural moment. You see this? Judas leaves. Now, being the treasurer, it's possible that they were like, oh, did he go pay for the food? Like, they just had the moment. You missed the moment. How did you not? Like, if they would have known, they should have just dogpiled on him there. right? Because they were, a lot of them were emotional, logical people, no doubt, but emotional people, fishermen, they were hardworking guys. If they would have known that their master, right, their pastor, their friend, their father, if you will, father figure in their life, was about to be betrayed, you know as well as I do, you got 11 guys in there, they weren't going to sit back and go, They're going after the guy. Somehow, they missed it. And Judas walks out. So now picture, he gets up and he leaves. And now we have 11 remaining disciples and the Messiah. And they begin to go through the Last Supper. They begin to have a moment here. As they're eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. You've seen this multiple times as we do communion, and as you maybe even do it on your own, and you read this passage, and he says, take this and eat it. This is my body. And the bread symbolizes, does not literally become, but symbolizes the body, the broken body of Jesus. And he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it and gave it to them and said, each of you drink from it, for this is my blood. And he passes around the cup, and they're having this moment. This is where this idea of holy communion, with the holy sacrament of communion, comes into place within the life of our church. It all started in this space and in this time with Jesus and 11 of the disciples. Judas was so blind. He was overtaken by Satan at this point in time, possibly even sooner than that, or multiple times. But nonetheless, we know that he completely misses out on this final intimate moment. And of course, we know never makes it to the later. And then during the communion time, they sing a hymn. This was very traditional, that at the end of their Passover meal, they would sing a hymn together that they would have all memorized. They wouldn't have had to pull out a book and turn to page 116. Like, they would have just known it. This is how they lived. This was their lifestyle. It wasn't just something that they casually did on the weekend. This was how they lived. And they breathed it continually. And so they just sang together. And then they began to walk out to the Mount of Olives. Now, walking out of the upper room, right? They come down from the upper room and they're walking out. I would imagine there's a little conversation. Where's Judas? And maybe even feeling a little like, wow, I don't know what's happening, but I feel good. And we're walking around the Messiah, right? After all, I still think this guy's going to take over Rome and just set up everything. Still hoping for that military leader, Messiah. And Jesus continues that small talk. On the way, Jesus told them, tonight, soon is one thing. Soon this will happen. Later this will go down. Jesus says, tonight, all of you will desert me. If I should say that, hey, we're gonna have a town hall meeting here this afternoon as a church family, and at the end of that, you're all gonna walk away, and I'm gonna ask for help, and you're gonna abandon that request. Because of our relationship, because how we know each other, we live close in proximity to each other, we see each other at stores around, like we know each other, we do life at times with each other, you would have that moment of, no, I wouldn't. Why would I have any need to do that? And so the disciples likewise start going down this road. Jesus even brings up Zechariah chapter 13, verse 7 in this passage. And he says, God will strike the shepherd and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. It's like, wow, no, that can't mean us. Like, what? But Jesus is already laying out a plan here. Just listen. I mean, I wish that I would listen better to the word of God, to the words of Jesus, because he makes it very clear, like, okay, so I'm going to go and do this, but after I have been raised from the dead, verse 32, I will go ahead to Galilee and I'll meet you there.
We have no mental map for what you're saying, Jesus. Okay, so you're going to go die on a cross for something you did not do, and then you're coming back to life? Still trying to process the whole temple being destroyed thing. And we're supposed to meet you up in Galilee? I don't know that none of them heard this. None of them clearly acted on this. And so Jesus is laying this out for them. If they would follow instructions, what faith though? Gosh. Well, he said he was going to come back to life, and we're gonna meet him in Galilee. Did you ever read that portion of that before? I think I've totally missed it every time. They were in such disarray. Some went, I don't know what else to do, I'm going fishing. Right? What we thought was going to happen didn't happen. The Messiah died, even though he said it was going to happen. Such sorrow, even within themselves, over this. Sometimes when we focus on what we think is true and not focus on what is actually true, we can miss the point, right? Have you ever lived a lie before? When somebody said to you, hey, it's for the best. Hey, it's the only way. We've even lived the lie in our culture of saying, it's not really a baby. And if Satan can get us to believe a lie, he can certainly get us to live out that lie. Judas, not that big of a deal, buddy. Come on. You can do this. And it's probable that some of the other disciples could have even been in on this. Not the betrayal, necessarily, but the whole, like, maybe there was something under the table or something. Here's why I would suggest that. When Jesus was anointed by the sinful woman with this oil, with this perfume, it's estimated that this perfume could have been thousands, up to $10,000 worth of perfume. And she said, bloop, poured it all over him. And you remember the disciples? They got so mad. What is wrong with you? What a waste. That should have been sold and given to the poor. We should have given it to the poor. They all got mad. And of course, Judas is mad because he's looking at this money going, man, I totally could have gotten a percent of that. I don't know. There's no indication of that. But why would they have been so mad like they were? None of them got what Jesus was saying. He says, no, this is a good thing. Jesus says, this is a good thing. So they're walking on the road and they're on their way. They're leaving the upper room, which is on the west side, traditionally speaking, of Jerusalem. It would be the southwestern point of the temple. They're now walking around up the Kidron Valley, up the east side of Jerusalem, on their way to a place you'll recognize, Gethsemane, the Garden of Gethsemane. And they're having this conversation. It wasn't a super short walk, so this would have been not days and days, but it would have been a long walk hearing this stuff. You're all going to betray me tonight. You're going to desert me tonight. Peter, oh, my dear emotional friend Peter, who I just love dearly, this disciple, declares, let me teach Jesus a thing or two. Even if everyone else deserts you, I will never. Oh, you got to be so careful with such words as always and never. I say it consistently within my family. Don't say never. Well, they're always bugging me. When they're sleeping, are they bugging you? No, can't say always. Peter declares, never, never will I desert you. And Jesus says, I tell you the truth, Peter, this is this very night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. You'll deny if you even knew me. No, Peter says. Can you imagine? Can you imagine standing before Jesus? And didn't they already have a moment about like, hey, Jesus, we won't let you go to Jerusalem and be killed. And Jesus says that really moment of get behind me, Satan. And we're right back in this moment of no, I'm not going to do it. It'll never happen. Even if I have to die with you, I will never deny you. And all the other disciples vowed the same. We're with you, Messiah. Let's go. Okay. We're going to switch our point of view one more time. In the greatest plot twist of all time, two of the disciples are about to do a heel turn on Jesus. Jesus knows this. The others do not. They were just told they were going to desert Jesus. But there's the denial and then there's the betrayal. And Jesus is aware of this. Now, you have to, Jesus was undoubtedly fully 100% God. God in the flesh. He was also 100% human. And so within his humanity, he felt things that we feel. And so imagine this. All he knows this is going down. All will desert him. Judas will betray him. Peter, the little pebble, will deny even knowing him. And all of this weighing on Jesus is on while he's on his way to die as a criminal for each one of them. He's aware of all of this as it is going down. And he's carrying this. Physically doesn't even have his cross yet. But he's carrying the weight of this. You want to talk about sorrow? Believers, this is to encourage us that we will never have it as rough or as tough or as intense as Jesus had it. He took it so we wouldn't have to. And so here we are. He has all this on him. And Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus went with them to the olive grove called Gethsemane. Now, Gethsemane would be, the garden would be at the foot of the Mount of Olives, like towards the, so if the Mount of Olives are here and then you go down and there would be the Garden of Gethsemane and then the temple's on the other side. So they're in the middle of these two. So you understand where they're at. And he said, sit here while I go over there to pray. And he took with them Peter and Zebedee's two sons, James and John. When Jesus, we walked through that story of the transfiguration of Jesus, do you remember who he took with him? Peter, James, and John. When you think about, they got to see a glimpse. Perhaps that prepared them in a way unlike the others, to now even walk through moments of sorrow with Jesus. He took Peter and James and John, and he became anguished and distressed. And he told them, my soul, now this is Jesus, the words of Jesus. Let's take it for what he tells us. My soul is crushed. And what is crushing my soul right now is grief to the point of death. I'm sure most of us have experienced sadness. But it's highly probable only a couple of us have ever experienced grief to the point of death. This is not just a sadness. This is an extreme, entire dejection and anguish, a horror of the mind. That's what Jesus is experiencing here. Have you ever experienced such weight? The closest thing we might be able to get to this, knowing all of this, perhaps the loss of a family member to addiction or death, loss of a child to sickness, a divorce, loss of a job. We can feel that weight on us. He goes and he prays to his heavenly Father three times. And he says the same thing three times, or very similar in nature, three times. Father, if it's possible for this cup of suffering to be taken from me, great. But if not, your will be done. Secondly, he says, if this cup cannot be taken from me unless I drink it, your will be done. And then Matthew doesn't even record the third one other than, and then he did it a third time and he said the same things. Consistently, regularly. He was already used to saying, your will be done, Father, not my own. The Son of God defaulted that to the Father. Your will be done, not my own. And then he comes back a final time and says, because he came back a couple times and they're sleeping, remember? They're so exhausted, they're wiped out. And for whatever reason, felt comfortable enough to like just kind of kick back and relax. And I don't think they're fully getting it yet. You know, if you're a parent, you have a sick kid, it's hard to sleep. You're restless. You're up at night. You're all over the place because you don't just sit back and relax. If you're sitting here with your Messiah knowing that somebody is coming and that night you're supposed to retreat and get away from Jesus and not all of them will deny him, but they'll get away from him and run away. And they're just... just sleeping. The third time he comes back and he says, get your rest. He says, go ahead and sleep. Have your rest. Now, I don't know if there was a long pause here because Jesus says, have your rest. And then he jumps right to this moment that says, but look, the time has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Up, let's be going. Look. My betrayer is here. And of course, I'm sure they all jumped up and they were ready to, what are we going to do? Jesus is standing with Peter, the one that will soon deny him, though he denied that he was going to deny him. And they look off into the distance and they see probably the torches and they saw light coming because it was nighttime, it was dark. And he knows what's happening. And he says, look, my betrayer is here. And there it is. The greatest plot twist of all times. And the first one is about to go down. They're both going to betray Jesus. They're both going to deny with their life. Their outcomes are going to be vastly different. You see, in the Garden of Eden, humanity was already turned heel on God. You know what that means, to turn heel? Literally. I'm with you, I'm with you. I'm not with you. One of the most heartbreaking heel turns as a teenager was when I used to watch WWF wrestling and the immortal Hulk Hogan became the third man in the new NWO. And they said, I can't believe it. Of all people, I never would have. You've seen movies where at the end of the movie you're going, how could he? It's that intensity. A little less immature than my experience. But it's that intensity when we look at that and say, okay, in the Garden of Eden, humanity through sin had already heel turned on Jesus, or on God. In our sin, we have already betrayed him. In our sin, we have already denied him. And yet, God showed his great love towards us in that while we were still enemies of God, he died for us. It's really hard not to come down on Judas and Peter. How dare you? How could you? You did this and you did that. And we're not that different from Jude. You just haven't been asked. You haven't been asked to give up your faith for $1 million. I pray with all that is in me that none of us would be so weak as to think that even the end of the barrel and somebody's looking down on us, that we would be willing to not understand that the glories that are to come far outweigh the pain and the sorrow that we experience here. I guess you don't know until you know. But if you don't start saying yes to Jesus more often now, you're going to have that, well, I really would, but I can't. Well, it sounds like a good idea, but I really can't. Lord, I know you want me to, but I'm really not going to go there. You're practicing your no. We have to stop that. If you know the Spirit of God is gripping you towards a direction, then go that direction. As scary as it can be, I gotta believe that if there was not just sorrow, but there was real repentance, Judas could have experienced restoration. And next week we'll look at how he simply did not. Which path are you on? Could be you. It could be someone you know. Here's our next steps. You could be headed for restoration. You could also be headed toward condemnation. How can I be in a right relationship with God? It's simple. Believe, receive, that you might become. You see, in Romans chapter 6, we're told that the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. And John 1 lays it out, but to all who believed him and received him, he gave the right to become children of God. And so if you know somebody who needs this, or you need this even today, a simple prayer is this. Look at this as I read it. Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. I believe you died for my sins so I could be forgiven. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. Help me become more like you. Thank you for coming into my life. Then you know, with real repentance, turning away from your sin and following Jesus. Every day you have to make this decision. When you wake up every morning and say, today's going to be a new day, today I choose to follow you with all I am, Jesus. If you say that every day, you get in the habit of saying that, and then when life comes at you, whether it's money or a bullet, you can say, listen, I've been saying it for years, I choose to follow him today. It's not something you really even have to think about, because you already have been doing it. Practice every morning, God, today I'm choosing to follow you and allow the Lord to use that to grow you into the person that he is calling you to be. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, as we've looked at these two men, Peter along the story and Judas, the tale of two failures, what an interesting thought. We can be so hard on these two guys, no doubt. But at times, we can be so close to betraying or denying you. Lord, I pray that you would give us the boldness to daily wake up and to say to you, I choose to follow you today. I give you all I have today. I honor you. I worship you. May that be the cry of our hearts as you have saved us from sin. You've saved us from ourselves. You saved us from eternal punishment. You rescued us. You paid the debt I could not pay. And so, out of your grace and your mercy, I get to receive that. Oh boy, if that doesn't say how much I don't deserve it, I don't know what does. And so I thank you for the free gift of this rescue. As we continue to follow the outcomes of these two men, I pray that you will strengthen us, that you will show us where we fall short, and help us also likewise to bring people alongside us who can be discipled, who we can encourage also. In Jesus' name we all say, amen. For next week, finish up Matthew 26, and we'll go into the first 10 verses of Matthew 27. Will you stand, and let's do our reading this morning before we head out. Don't forget, this afternoon, after our 11 o'clock worship gathering, we are going to stuff some eggs. That'll be fun. And so, you know, you stuff one, eat one. No, don't do that. And we'll be able to do that together. What a great opportunity to connect with your church family. Let's read this together. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Now all glory to God, who is able through his mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think. Glory to him in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Now let's go and be the church.